Let's see here. All right. Can you hear me?
I can. Good morning.
Good morning. How are you doing, Joe?
I'm doing well. Looking forward to this.
Awesome. Awesome. Well, you know, I'm looking forward to it as well. This has been several months in the works and, you know, I appreciate all of your support throughout the entire thing. And I'm going to go ahead and, you know, get us started. So I'm sure you've used the Zoom platform before with other, your other stuff. So you're familiar with how to get the actual sharing started. So I will turn it over to you. And then let me ask you this real quick before we get started, Joe. Do you want the attendees to submit questions throughout, or do you want to hold them to the end, or do you want me to have them just, you know, email them? We can always shoot them over to you, or how do you want to handle that? You don't have to have questions at all. It's up to you.
Yeah. I think it depends on the time. So,
okay.
Yeah, we'll just play it by ear.
Well, you just let me know what your drop dead time is and I'll make sure that happens.
Okay, cool. Sounds good. Yeah. I think we had about 20 to 30 minutes scheduled for this. So, you know, whatever we can do within that time frame, I'm good with, however you want to handle it.
Sure. No problem at all. Well, I appreciate it. We were talking about you a little bit before. You probably heard us if you were on ahead of time, kind of teasing you up a little bit. But let me give a quick introduction for Joe while he's getting his screen shared there. And then I'll go ahead and turn it over to him and have him get us started. So, you know, Joe is, as I've mentioned before, is my mentor. And I was really excited to have him, you know, accept being able to keynote and start this entire event off. And so Joe, if you don't know who he is the host of the longest real estate podcast. He's been doing it for, I don't know, 5 years now, almost 5 years since 2000. Yeah. He's been in real estate since 2008 and investing, but check out his podcast on iTunes. He controls over $460 million in real estate. I think he might even be over half a billion by now. I'm not sure about that for sure. Is that correct, Joe?
We're at 470 and we've got about 100 under contract right now. We'll be closing next month.
Killing it, man. I love it. Awesome. So he's the host of the world's longest running daily real estate podcast called Best Real Estate Investing Advice Ever. And he's authored a book by the same title, actually two of them. And he also has a book that he just came out with a couple of months ago that is called the Best Ever Apartment Syndication Book. And so you can find that on Amazon. And I would highly recommend you get that if you have not gotten it yet. And you can find it on Amazon. And he also is a coach to many students in the multifamily investing space. And so I'll turn it over to you, Joe. Thank you so much for being with us. And I will be here in the background in case you need me for anything.
Okay, sounds good. And I see the screen, my face on the screen, but is my presentation being shared as well? Do you see it?
It is.
Okay, sweet.
Yep, well, you're good.
Yeah, thank you so much for that intro. And I mean, first off, what an incredible conference. I mean, what an amazing idea that you had, Dan, and thank goodness that you gathered a bunch of us so that we can all learn from each other. And that's what this is all about. One thing that I did in preparation for this conversation is I did an analysis of all the investors that I have in our deals to date, excuse me, where they're from, geographically, but then also how I got to know all of them. And I thought it would be interesting because my business is to partner with accredited investors and we buy apartment communities. So I thought it would be interesting for you if you're looking to partner with other investors, whether or not you're buying apartment communities, that's one thing. But if you're looking to scale your business through partnerships and bringing on private investors, what I thought would be interesting is to take a look at where I'm getting my investors from, what are the lead sources, and then, you know, simply share that with you. And then you can then replicate that so that you can get lead sources to ultimately, you know, grow your business. And when I say ultimately grow your business, why are we looking to grow our business? First off, I believe that it's important to have our intentions in order so that we're doing something greater than we're doing something that we want to do that is greater than ourselves. I believe that we can do things only so much if we do it for ourselves, but then if we have better intentions, if we have reasons larger than ourselves, then we'll be able to do more things. So the outcome for our conversation today is to help you reach more people, help you help more people reach their financial goals so that in turn you'll achieve your financial goals. You know, I always think about if a family is on, you know, if a family is in a tough situation financially and, you know, they're barely scraping by, they're, you know, month to month. All of a sudden, you know, they have a child, and typically that child does not go hungry when they have a new mouth to feed. Well, how are they able to all of a sudden have the ability when they were month to month before to feed the child? And the answer is that we rise above to certain situations that life presents us. And, you know, we can either have life dictate those situations to us, and sometimes regardless of how much we anticipate things, that happens. Or we can think, okay, if I want to put myself in this situation now so that life doesn't dictate this situation. So I'm already pretending that this situation has occurred and I'm going to act accordingly. And when we do that, then we're going to achieve greater things because we're already mentally putting ourselves in a situation where, you know, we need to rise above. And that's the same thing here. You know, when we're thinking about our business and we want to grow our business, well, we can think, okay, I want to grow my business because today I want to just get larger. Or I can think, okay, what if I had a circumstance take place and I needed, not want, but I needed to make things happen? And think about really putting yourself in that situation, and then ultimately you're going to grow into that. So that's the outcome for our conversation today. And you know, a couple quotes that come to mind I've lived by through my entrepreneurial journey. One is service to many leads to greatness, and the other is help enough people get what you want, get what they want, you'll eventually get everything you want. And then on my vision board, Tony Robbins quote that he talks about is the secret to living is giving. And you know, that's something that he mentioned in his TED Talk. If you haven't seen the Tony Robbins TED Talk, I highly recommend that. So a little bit about me really quick. I'm the author of the Best Ever Apartment Syndication book. So again, my business is buying apartment communities with accredited investors. I have interviewed over 1,000 real estate investors. I believe that I have interviewed more real estate investors than anyone else in the world. If you know someone who's interviewed more real estate investors, you know, and I've interviewed about 1,500 real estate investors, than that, let me know. But I believe I've interviewed more real estate investors than anyone else in the world. Well, why is that relevant? Well, it's relevant because I've learned a couple things as a result of it. And it's also relevant because we're going to be talking about how you will attract accredited investors or just investors in general to your deals, whether or not you're doing apartment communities or fix and flip in or whatever else. There are ways to attract investors to deals, and the podcast certainly is one of them that we'll talk about. And then, as Dan mentioned in the introduction, $470 million worth of apartment communities. I'm the co-founder of Ashcroft Capital. We've got about $100 million worth of apartment communities under contract right now. We'll be closing on in the next 45 days or so, which will put us over the $500 million mark. So what's the number one reason why people invest in your deal? You know, think about it from, you know, from when, if you were presented an opportunity. Well, if you got an email from someone you didn't know, but it had really good returns and it was a really good market and it seemed like it was a really intelligent investment strategy, would you invest with them? You didn't know them. You just got the email out of the blue. No, right? You would not invest. At least initially, you wouldn't invest. You might follow up with them, even if it was an email out of the blue, and get to know the opportunity. But ultimately, what are you really doing? You're really getting to know them. And when we enter into the business, we want to make sure. And when I say enter into the business, I mean when we enter into the business, the part of your business where you're evolving the business so that you're bringing on accredited investors or just bringing on passive investors or other business partners who are investing their money. So if maybe you've been in the business for a while, but you're evolving your business, or maybe you're looking to take it to another level, you want to make sure that you establish trust with your potential investors. Well, there's a couple ways or a couple components of trust. One is personally, they have to personally trust you. Think about Jim Halpert from The Office, right? He's totally trustworthy guy. I mean, if The Office were real, in real life, and I were to meet Jim Halpert, I would get along with him. He's a nice guy from The Office. Well, would I invest with him on a fix and flip that he's doing? Well, nice guy, but I'm not sure, because I'm not sure how much he knows about fix and flips. And I'd have to learn more about his track record. I'd have to learn more about how he thinks about it. I'd have to learn more about how he mitigates the risk. So there are two components to establishing trust with your investors. One is time. And I imagine you're a good person. I imagine you're a good person. I imagine that people who know you well, those in your inner circle, your friends, your family, they're like, yeah, I'll vouch for him or her. Well, that's one component, and it's a very important and necessary component. But then also the challenge that most of us have when they are bringing on investors, and I had this, was establishing the business person trust in our industry. So, when I was getting started, I was in advertising. I was an advertising executive working on Madison Avenue. And I had the trust of those who knew me through life. Okay, great. But when I was starting to put together a deal for an apartment community, well, wait a second. They trust me as a person, but did I have that established trust as a apartment investor? And so there's a distinction there. And so knowing that that's the case, because Jim, going back to Jim Halpert example, with the, you trust him as a person, or at least I do. And I certainly would trust him to tell me all about the paper products that Dunder Mifflin has, but would I trust him on a fix and flip to partner up? I don't know. So there has to be relevant strategic trust about something. And whatever you're focused on. So as a business person, we've got to establish that relevant strategic trust about whatever you're focused on. So if it's fix and flips, okay, great. We've got to establish ourselves as a thought leader to educate people on whatever we do. So there are two components to trust. One is time, which you probably have already checked the box with those who are closest to you, but those who are closest to you, would they immediately invest in whatever you're doing? If so, then great. Then you've established the second part of that, which is expertise. But how about people who know, or how about your family and friends who, their family and friends, or excuse me, their friends, would they invest with you? And so as the circle widens and the degrees of separation increase, then perhaps that expertise has not been established. So the approach for our conversation today, when I talk about five ways to attract investors or passive investors in your deals, in my case, they're accredited investors, don't have to be in your case. It's really about establishing not only trust, but expertise and relevant trust. That's really what it is. It's trust, and then it's relevant trust as it relates to whatever you're focused on. So really what the title of this conversation could have been, but it's not nearly as succinct, so that's why I didn't call it this, is five proven ways to build strategic, scalable trust with passive investors. And the key here, well, there are a lot of keys, but one thing I haven't talked about already I want to mention is scalable. Because there are many ways to gain strategic relevant trust with investors, but you'll want to create things that are scalable so that you're creating the strategic trust with investors while you're catching your Z's, or while you're doing some other stuff, while you're working on deals, so that passive investors or potential partners of yours, joint venture partners of yours, can learn about who you are and what you got going on whenever you're not in front of them. That truly is scalable trust. It's when I get leads on my website. You know, I've got something that we'll talk about that I recommend you have, which is investwithjoe.com. It's just investwithjoe.com. It sends you to a website where you fill out a form to potentially invest or look at our deals and we get to know each other. I recommend you have something like that too, investwithfillinyourblank.com. And whenever I get an inquiry from there, there's a drop down menu or radio buttons where the investor selects how they heard about me. And it's such a different conversation when they've heard about me through one of my platforms versus online search. When they've heard about me through online search, the conversation goes something like, hi, nice to meet you. I saw that you submitted your information to us and that you're accredited. You're looking to invest at least $50,000. I see your background here that you submitted. I'd love to get to know you and learn more about you. So they tell me more about themselves. And then they ask me, okay, so remind me again, what your company is Ash what? And I'll say Ashcroft. And they're like, okay. And again, what all do you do? Or you do ground up development or you do retail and apartments? I'm like, no, we just do value add apartment communities. And tell me a little bit more about your background. And then I talk about my background. And the conversation is not about business. It's about them establishing trust in me and getting to know who I am, which is totally expected because they just found me through online search. Compared to when they select the option of they heard about me on my podcast or an event or something like this. Oh, it's completely different. It's okay. I see that you submitted your information. I'd love to get to know you. They tell me about themselves. And then they just ask the relevant questions. Cause usually if they heard about me from my podcast, the conversation starts out as, I feel like I already know you, Joe, because I've been listening to your podcast for X number of years because I've got over 1,500 episodes. It's such a smoother conversation. And from a business standpoint, why is that relevant? Well, one, it's more efficient with my time and their time. But then two, the likelihood for them to invest is three times as high. Now, I haven't done a study on this part of it, but I guarantee you it's at least three times as high versus someone who finds me just through an online search. So here are five proven ways, and these are the main ways that I have attracted my investors that I wanted to share with you. So I did a word cloud, and I did a word cloud to easily show the visualization of this, and here they are. These are the five. They're multiple, more than five, but the bigger the word, the more, the greater the number of inquiries. So, it makes the word bigger. And first, number one is podcast. So, okay. Do you have to have a podcast? No, you don't have to have a podcast, but what you do need to have is an interview-based thought leadership platform. If you read my book, The Best Ever Apartment Syndication Book, if you listen to my podcast or, seen any of my conferences, you knew I was going to mention this, right? You knew it. And, an example of this is Dan Hanford. He's got a daily podcast, Tough Decisions podcast. And when I started working with him, he said, I'm going to do it daily. I'm like, okay, are you sure? Because I've been doing a daily podcast for, 4.5 or so years. It's time consuming at the beginning when you, eventually you can scale it, but it's time consuming at the beginning. Well, he's a gung-ho guy and very ambitious and makes things happen. And he did it. Daily podcast, $125 million worth of real estate right now. I was just reading your bio, Dan. $125 million worth of real estate, 1,300 plus apartment units. And he is all in on the daily podcast. So it does not have to be a daily podcast, but I would argue that the more frequently you do whatever you're choosing to do, and it could be a podcast, it could be a YouTube channel, it could be a blog, whatever your frequency, the higher the frequency, the higher likelihood you'll achieve your results faster and efficient and safe way or safer way. And with the interview-based thought leadership platform, the reason why it's interview-based, and that's there for a reason, is because that builds in a promotional component for what you're doing. So when you're having those conversations with the guests, I mean, you know this, right? Then they will want to share it out with their people. And then when they share it out with their people, then it brings you and more people to listen to your show or watch your YouTube channel. Or if you don't want to be on camera and don't want to put together a podcast, then on your blog. But the challenge with if you do a blog versus YouTube channel or a podcast is if you're creating a blog from scratch, there's not a built-in audience, and you simply want to leverage built-in audiences. So iTunes, bunch of millions of people. I don't know how many people are on iTunes. YouTube, same thing. So you've already got a built-in audience. So why recreate the wheel? Why not tie into that? So I highly recommend doing podcast or YouTube channel, and then having different ways to share that out through social media. Number two, bigger pockets. You know bigger pockets, right? But here's something that you might not know. And the number is 6,702. What am I talking about? 6,702. Well, 6,702 people have got the addict badge. Where is that award? Dun, 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 dun. There it is. Okay. The column far left, second one from the bottom, addict award on bigger pockets. I'm sure you know you can get awards on bigger pockets, and there's no ceremony or anything like that. It's just you do something a certain amount of times, and they have different awards that they give you. 6,702 people have been awarded the addict award on bigger pockets. How many people are there on bigger pockets? Well, according to bigger pockets website I looked yesterday, over 1.2 million people. 6,702 people have been awarded the addict badge, and to be awarded the addict badge, you must be on the site every day for 1 month. 6,702 people have done that. I'm one of them. 1.2 million people are on the website. So half of a percent, top half of a percent. Why is this important? Well, going back to the thought leadership platform, do it daily, you get results faster than if you do weekly, than if you do monthly, than certainly if you do it sporadically. Same thing with bigger pockets. Bigger pockets, as you see here, which shows the ways I get new investors coming to me. I mean, that's number two or number three, bigger pockets. And so, why not focus on bigger pockets? So I do. And so there's some tactical things that you can do on bigger pockets to enhance the results that you experience. So one is make sure you have your keyword set up. Obviously you do that already. Two is get a pro account. The reason why you need, not want, the reason why you need a pro account is because you get your website in your signature, and whenever you post, then you can send people to your website. So you're driving traffic from your posts on bigger pockets to your website. Three is you might have the question of, well, okay, I am active on BiggerPockets, Joe, but I don't have a whole lot to say sometimes. And that's fine. No one wants to hear someone talk just for the sake of them talking, right? Whether they're talking verbally or whether they're, you know, in written form. So I appreciate that thought. And so does, you know, all the other community members, I imagine. But what you can do if you have nothing to talk about on a post, and sometimes posts, you know, you really don't have anything you can do, but 9 times out of 10, you have something you can write on the post. And here is what that thing, that something is. If you have nothing to do with that post, let's say for me, fix and flips. I've never fix and flipped a property, but I know fix and flippers who are on BiggerPockets. So if I'm on a fix and flip post and someone's asking a question, I'll simply say, I'll comment about whatever they're doing. So they might say, I've got a property under contract. I'm trying to learn renovation costs for this fix and flip. Here's where I live. Can people help me out? Well, I'm not that guy, but what I can do is I can say, hey, congrats on getting the fix and flip under contract. I don't have any experience in fix and flips or this market, so I'm definitely not the right person, but, and then I'll tag someone who does fix and flips or who does live in that market. There's a book called How to Be a Power Connector by Judy Robinette. And in that book, that's essentially what she says. You can connect people, you be a matchmaker, and by being a matchmaker, you're able to add value to people's lives and also be relevant with those people. How beautiful is that? You're not bringing any knowledge about something that you don't know about. You're not pretending to know something that you don't know, but you're somehow adding amazing value to the conversation by simply matching up people who can help each other out. It's a wonderful thing. By doing that, you're adding value to the community. You're also getting votes. And when people do a Google search for your name, when prospective investors do a Google search for your name, then they're going to likely see your BiggerPockets profile. They will also, if they're on BiggerPockets, they're going to go check out your posts. They might even ask people about you. And then when they see that you've posted a decent amount of times, over 1,000 times, and they see that you got about at least 1,000 votes or 500 votes, so every other post or so, you get a vote. And they're going to check the box from a, you will get farther along in having them check the box on you being a strategic expert in whatever you're focused on. And that's what this is all about, right? Going back to the whole trust thing. They might trust you as a person, but do they trust you as a business person who is an expert at whatever you're doing? And BiggerPockets certainly will help you with that. And those are some specific ways that I've used BiggerPockets to help grow my business and get investors. So my suggestion to you, my challenge to you on this one, become an addict of BiggerPockets. Get that award. Be in the top 0.5%. I was shocked. 6,702 people as of yesterday have got that award. Over 1.2 million people on BiggerPockets. I hear a lot of people say, yeah, hey, I'm so motivated. I'm all in. I'm ready to go. And they know intellectually that BiggerPockets can help them with their business. But are they consistent with it? 0.5%. Be that 0.5%. Third thing. You can see here, BEC stands for Best Ever Conference. I do that every year in February in Denver. And then Meetup is, Meetup stands for Meetup. pretty intuitive there, right? Number 3, create a local Meetup group. And if you have time to attend a meetup, which if you're listening to this, you're kind of attending a meetup, right? Because you're doing a virtual summit. So you've got time to attend this. You also have time to create something like this. You have time to create a local meetup, or you could create something virtual like this. Just don't do it around the same time as Dan, right? Because Dan will, I don't want to get in trouble, Dan. But you have the ability to create something. And when you create something, you're automatically elevated to the level, to a higher level, from a perception standpoint. And going back to what we were discussing earlier, it's about establishing trust as a person and then also trust as a business person. So if you're, say you're just getting started in real estate, which I doubt you are, but let's just say you are, because then this certainly is applicable to you if you already have experience. If you're just getting started and you're like, oh man, okay, I started a meetup, Joe, really? What do I have? I won't have anything to talk about. I'm just getting going. Well, that's okay. Then don't talk much. Just simply introduce people at your meetup and have them talk. Just be a coordinator. Just be a coordinator of events. And the thought might be, because I've heard this before, I'm really good with people, and when I meet people, the relationships are long lasting. So I'm just going to do that. I don't necessarily want to do a meetup because I'm not sure about the time or some other reason. Well, meeting people one-on-one and relying on organic referrals, as you'll see in a little bit, because that's the number one way I get new referrals, very valuable. And it is a good way. But just like your business, you need multiple income streams with your business, right? Well, you need multiple ways of getting investors and deals if you're going to grow your business. And so my suggestion is to do the meetup, but don't just do a local meetup. If you do just a local meetup, then make sure that you're capturing that content through through your phone and then posting it on YouTube or doing Facebook Live or Instagram story or whatever else, so that you're scaling that out. Because remember earlier I was talking about, this is a conversation about strategic ways to attract accredited investors that scale. So a local meetup group, if you're in Asheville, North Carolina, two thumbs up, great job. But what about people who are outside of Asheville? I imagine some of the things you're talking about at that local meetup group are relevant to people outside of Asheville. Now, there might be a presentation or two that's just about Asheville, but there likely are insights that you have and things that are talked about that are relevant to other people. So do Facebook Live and put it on YouTube, and then you'll be able to build your audience that way. And so what I did, very interesting analysis. I did this last year, this thing I'm about to tell you. 2.5% of my investors, both, actually all 2.5% of my current investors, not potential and current, just current investors, 2.5% of my current investors live in Cincinnati, Ohio. I moved to Cincinnati about 3-4 years ago. My wife's from here. So we live here, lovely city. I'm happy that we live here, but it's not necessarily known for, having a bunch of high net worth individuals, right? It's a large city. It's got some, but it's not the Miami, New York City, Los Angeles, San Francisco's of the world. So 2.5% of my investors live in Cincinnati, but 13 point something of all of my investors, current investors, in terms of dollar amounts, come from Cincinnati. So Cincinnati investors are investing a disproportionately higher amount in my deals compared to New York, Miami, LA, any other city in the United States. Why is that? Well, I've only been here 4 years. The first thing I did when I came to Cincinnati is I started a meetup. One of the first things, but one of the first business things I did was start a meetup. I've been doing a monthly meetup for, you know, however long I've been here. And through that meetup, investors in Cincinnati have gotten to know me. And we've built a great long-term relationship. And that has helped do have that disproportionate percentage or that disproportionate ratio. 2.5% of my investors live in Cincinnati, but of the total equity invested in our deals, 13.something% are comes from Cincinnati investors. That's the there's no other city in the U.S. from my investors where it's that disproportionate, and it's because of this. So you can go deep with investors when you have a local meetup. I know some people, some of my clients who get their investors, their first investors from their local meetup because they simply get to know them. And again, they establish the personal trust, but then also the business person trust. Number four, referrals. This isn't in order. This is not in order of how the number of leads, because I think referrals are actually the number one way I get leads. You can, I guess, judge by how big these words look, but I feel like referrals or maybe podcasts are larger. Anyway, these are the top three, obviously, referrals, podcasts, and Bigger Pockets. So referrals, how do you generate referrals? I save voicemails from my grandma. She's 103 years old. She is sharp as a tack. And yeah, I love her dearly. So anytime she leaves me a voicemail, I save it. And, you know, for obvious reasons, I want to, you know, make sure that, yeah, if she's leaving me a voicemail today, that I save it. And, you know, it's our all of our time's limited, but, you know, she's 103. So I really value the conversations I have with her. So I save all my voicemails from my grandma, who's 103. I save all my voicemails from my mom. And I save all my voicemails from Colleen, my wife. Most of the voicemails from Colleen, my wife. and there's one more whose voicemail I've saved. It was an investor. It is an investor. He left me a voicemail. And it was about a minute and a half long. He called me up on a Saturday morning. I was still asleep. So he called me up, left me a voicemail. And he said, "Joe, I just want to thank you for the work and the type of communication that you have with me and the rest of the investors on the deals." He said, "I've invested in 12 different types of syndications, 12 different groups. And you all are by far best at delivering on what you say you're going to deliver on. And the monthly reporting that you provide and getting the K-1s out on time and being responsive whenever I need to, you know, change my payment information from a check to, you know, ACH or change bank accounts, whatever it is. And I just want to call and thank you for that. Have a great weekend." I saved it, still have it, shared with the team. That's how you build referrals. It's, quite frankly, it's shockingly easy. But what's equally shocking is people don't do what they say they're going to do. I don't know why, but more often than not, people aren't going to do what they say they're going to do. I'm not sure why that's someone in psychology who can help us out with why people don't follow through with what they say they're going to do on a consistent basis over a long period of time. Not sure why, but when acknowledging that that's typically the case, we can stand out by simply doing what we say we're going to do and having consistent communication with investors and with people. So if you don't have a deal yet and you're looking to bring on investors, then going back to the first thing I was mentioning about the thought leadership platform, having consistent content so that they're becoming acclimated to hearing your voice or reading your stuff or watching you on YouTube, that helps with this. That helps with referrals. I've been on many calls with a listener of my podcast and his or her father or mother who they've recommended invest in our deal, so we all got to get to know each other. Happens often. And so even if someone isn't necessarily a potential business partner, the word of mouth increases because you're doing something on a consistent basis. So thought leadership platform, doing something, doing that consistently, that's one thing. But when you say you're going to follow up, you follow up. And I'm sure everyone listening, I mean, you're taking your valuable time to, you know, attend this conference. So you're already in, you know, another level from what's typical. And so I imagine you do follow through. So because you do follow through, you will stand out as long as you continue to do it consistently. And it's crazy to think that that's type of stuff that will be a unique value proposition, but it is, because for whatever reason, generally speaking, people don't do what they say they're going to do on a consistent basis over a period of time. One other thing I'll mention about that is having communication and updating your investors on a monthly basis is a must, not a should. It's a must. Because what happens, you know, I've got over 1,000 investors in our deals. I send out emails every month by the 14th of the month, updating investors on the properties that they're invested in. I might get 2, maybe 3 emails back asking follow-up questions. And perhaps 2 to 3 of those emails are from people just saying, hey, great job, appreciate it. And it's because I'm proactive with the communication, thinking about what questions will they have. So we make sure we address those in the email and then doing it consistently. That way I don't get the email, hey, can you jump on a call and catch me up on what's going on at property X? Well, I don't get those calls. I don't get those emails because they get the monthly updates. And so by doing it monthly, if you're doing a fix and flip or whatever else, if you're doing fix and flip, maybe that's weekly, I don't know. But doing it monthly actually saves you time because you're proactively addressing things. And then lastly, got JA, which stands for Junior Achievements, teeny tiny, right? And then Tech Board, which is the Texas Tech Alumni Advisory Board. Volunteering. Texas Tech Alumni Advisory Board, I've been on for a while. Junior Achievement, been on for less than that, about 3 years. Alumni Advisory Board, been on for probably 10 or so years. And my first investor, one of my first investors, I got 12 investors in my first deal. One of my first investors, I met her on the Texas Tech Alumni Advisory Board. Junior Achievement, one of the first things I did after I created my meetup when I moved to Cincinnati was join the Junior Achievement board, and because I'd been involved in that in New York City, and I have investors from that board. And you know, so you're furthering your business, but that's not the primary reason why you're doing it. The primary reason why you're doing it is you're doing good stuff. You're helping others. And when you do that, you gain that perspective, and That's also important in this business because we got tons of challenges, right? Everyone's got problems. Everyone's got challenges. And the volunteering puts things into perspective, at least for me. While also, when you think about people who are on boards of nonprofits, who do you think of? You think of higher net worth individuals, right? Generally speaking, they're going to be higher net worth individuals, vice presidents, presidents, CEOs, CFOs, entrepreneurs. And those are and people who would be great partners for you on your deals because they've got enough on their plate, most likely with their primary occupation. And so they're looking for ways to get into real estate and boom, there you go. But it's important to go in with good and pure intentions with an organization that you believe in and then volunteer and then eventually become on the board. As long as you go in with pure intentions, then, you know, two thumbs up because you're helping your investors who you meet on the board achieve their financial goals, as I mentioned at the very beginning, which will in turn help you achieve yours. So that's our conversation today. Really enjoyed it. Hope you got some value from this. And that's all I got.
Well, Joe, thank you so much for taking your time to be with us here today. I am very, very glad and very thankful for you to be here. So I know it was, something you don't usually, do as far as these webinars and stuff like that. And I know that you don't really like them. So and I don't care if everybody has their different opinions and stuff like that about, whatever, but, I really appreciate you taking the time. Great advice, great tips for those of you who have just joined us. Go ahead and grab his book on Amazon. He's got a great book. It is got raving reviews. If you go to our Facebook group, we even asked about some of the top books that have been written on multifamily and apartment syndication. And his was definitely the book that was glowing out of all the other ones as to a great book to be able to grab. And one of the best books out there that just got published a couple months ago. It's called The Best Ever Apartment Syndication Book. And you can find it on Amazon and also see all the reviews on there. Lots of comments coming through saying very, 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 I'm glad you came on. Very good book. So thank you so much, Joe. I appreciate your time and wish you the very best.
Hey, grateful for this and nice work on putting this together. And thanks everyone and enjoy the conference.
Thanks again. All right, we are finished with the first session of the day, which is the keynote. I'm going to stop the recording here.